I welcome everyone for this today's evening function. I just want to make it clear that this will go for about 30 minutes or 45 minutes. If you want, I can make it even an hour or 1.5 hour or 2 hours. But I don't want to make you to sit here with starving stomachs. It is already 7:15. I'll see to that it is completed in just 30 minutes or just 45 minutes. Now this topic, what I'm going to talk, is not a hi-fi topic. It is a very simple one. It is a subject or a topic anybody can understand, and I'm not going to give about the technical inputs. What I wanted to present is some of the statistics which probably enlighten the audience and probably which makes the audience to realize where we stand with regards to the water resources, how dangerous we are right now. So what will be the future, what will be the future scenario of the water resources, and how this future population is going to face this particular problem. Now if this come to the topic, it is rainwater harvesting, why we have to go for rainwater harvesting, and how it has to be done. And prior to going to the actual details, I just wanted to put before you some of the facts and figures, so that we can really realize, so we can, every one of you who are present here can understand what the magnitude of the water problem, what we are facing now, and what could be the future scenario. So now, if we just look into, as earlier, you have seen some of the documentaries in which the people have given the messages. And I just wanted to tell you one thing, that start this topic with a saying that look into the water for life, look into the water for life, and into the life, and life into the water, look into the water for the life. In the sense, if water is there, a clear water, just leave it for some time. Maybe for about a day, another 10 days or 15 days or a month. Afterwards, you can just see the life. Similarly, look into our life, we'll be able to realize the water. So that is what in one of the documentaries it has been given, that the human body consists of 70% of the water. So without water, there are no human beings at all. So without water, nothing can sustain or nothing can survive in the world. So with that, I wanted to proceed further, and also I just wanted to make it one thing clear, that many of you may not be aware that ours is the Hindustan. So don't read in between the lines. Maybe the politicians might have used the word for their own political gains. We are not politicians. We just look, if we just see the meaning of the Hindustan, we can understand. As per the Persian language, the Hindustan is nothing but the land of water. When the Persians started invading the Indian subcontinent, the moment they just stepped into the Indian subcontinent, they have seen the water everywhere, the plenty of water, which they have not seen in their own place. So after seeing the water everywhere, they named this land as the Hindustan. So in the name of the country itself, water is there. But now we are facing the water crisis. But one thing is clear, one thing I just want to make it clear, that water crisis or water problem is not a present day problem. It was there during the mythic period, even during the historic period, even now, and even in future also, we are going to face the problem unless we meticulously plan, try to manage the available resources. The days that are ahead will be quite miserable. So that's what I told you earlier. This particular problem, water problem, is not present day problem only. It was there during the mythic period. That is what, if some of you recollect what you have studied earlier regarding the Bhagirtha and all that. It is a mythic, mythic text. So it is up to you to believe or not to believe. But Bhagirtha was a person, Bhagirtha was the person who has brought the Ganga to the Ganga onto the earth. That is what, as per the mythology. So you can believe or not to believe. It is only the faith. But there is a point, there is a bone of contention that it has to be believed. So do not in toto, at least to some extent. So what I want to say is, the Bhagirtha started praying the Lord Shiva. In order to see that the Ganga comes down to the earth. So even if you just see the evolution of the earth, Indian subcontinent, the land what we are seeing now, Indian subcontinent what we are seeing now, it is not what it was early. Yeah. So you can just see this picture, you can understand. So this is what the Indian subcontinent, and this is the Sri Lanka, and it was surrounded by the sea. The Sri Lanka was supposed to be a small island, and India was supposed to be a very big island. So what has happened over a period of time? So it is about 70 million years. So it has been shifted towards the north. So maybe 65 years ago, it has been slightly shifted, they migrated, and after 38 million years, the portion of the Indian subcontinent was here, and 10 million it was here, and then today it is here. So what has happened was, the problem, you might have heard about the plate tectonics. So the entire crust, earth crust, is not made of a single rock mass. It consists of several plates. So these plates are bound to converge or diverge. So what has happened was, this Indian Indian plate started moving towards the Asian plate, and once it struck with the Asian plate, the Indian plate has gone below the Asian plate, and in that process, the Himalayan hill ranges have been formed. We say that the Ganga is born in Himalayan hill ranges. So what I want to just say is, maybe during that period, when the Himalayans were about to form, the Bhagirtha might have been there. So he started praying the Lord Shiva. So at one point of time, so because of this continental collision, due to the compression of rock formations, a huge mighty Himalayan hill ranges have been formed, and subsequently the glacial process has taken place, and once the glacial process has taken place, the Ganges have been developed over a period of time. Now you can just see a huge river of the Ganges. So maybe it is a mythology, but still there is a reason to believe that it might have been a truth. So though it is a mythic test, but still we can believe that one. So go back. So not only that, even if we just go back to 14th century, I don't know how many of you are aware, there was a very famous poet, famous writer. His name is Srinath. He has written so many novels. And poetry also. So he was living during the 14th century, and that particular place where he was living was, it is a part of Karnataka, presently it is a part of Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. So he was there in the court of a country. He was supposed to be a poet working for that particular country. So what? No, on those days, nobody was owning the land. The entire land belongs to the king. If somebody wanted to go for irrigation, so they have to take land from the king and then go for the irrigation. So as usual, he also requested the king to allow some land on cess. So he has to pay some money. So what has happened was, he started cultivating, and during that period, there was a famine for about 5 continuous years. He was not able to pay the cess. So obviously he got the capital punishment by the king, and the king has ordered him to drag him around the capital just by putting a boulder, huge boulder on his neck. Basically, he's a poet. When he's been subjected to agony, obviously, what will happen? The poetry will come. Spontaneously started telling the poetry. So you may not be able to understand the Telugu. I'll just tell you the English version. He started scolding Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva, you're a beggar. You're not a well-to-do person like Mahavishnu. He is rich, not on his own. Because of his wife, he is rich. Because of Lakshmi, he is rich. Though, since he is very rich man, Mahavishnu is so rich, he can marry n number of women. He has married 16,000 women. He can manage because he is a very rich personality. You are a beggar. You don't have proper housing. You don't have proper clothing. You don't have food. You have to beg for food also. So why do you want to have two wives? Leave Ganga, be happy with Parvati. This is what the essence of that is, now the poem. So what this I'm just telling you to make you to be clear that the famine or this water crisis or water problem is not present day problem. It was there even during the historic period. They faced the problem. So it's because of the lack of technology. So now we are facing the problem because of the technology. So now we can pump the water even from 500 or 600 feet or 700 feet or 800 feet or even 1,500 feet or 5,000 feet. On those days, though the water was there, they never had the technology. Whatever water was there on the stream, now in the streams, they were using. So maybe they had the wells, maybe to a depth of about 10 or 15 feet depth. But below 10 feet depth, there was huge amount of water, but they could not able to use that to come out of the problem. So they faced, because of the lack of technology, now we are facing the problem because of the technology. So because of the technology, what we are trying to do is, indiscriminately, we have started pumping water, which is available in the deep-seated layers. So in Pondicherry, if you just see the depth of the wells, the maximum depth is about 700 feet. Even the water that is there at 700 feet, we are drawing water from the subsurface and using indiscriminately. Like whenever you just go, even by a bus, you can just see on the roadside, people take bath under the tap. They just open the tap, take bath, and leave the tap as such and go. So that's the reason, now that is the problem we are facing. So we have technology, now the problem is we don't have water. Still I remember when I was a small kid, we used to draw the water with a bucket. Manually we used to draw the water. The maximum depth of the well was about only 10 meters, that is 30 feet or 35 feet or maximum 40 feet. I'm telling about 1970s. Now you just imagine. I don't know how many of you have seen. Even in my own village, where I was born and brought up, the well depth has gone to 400 feet. On those days, people were surviving because of the open wells. With the help of the open wells, they were surviving. There used to be some water. Now, all the open wells have been dried up. So because of more and more usage of water, and if you use in a right way, it is all right. So we are using indiscriminately, we are wasting so much of the water. So that's what, if you just see the statistics, the amount of water what we use to irrigate 1 acre of land in India, with same amount of water in Israel, they irrigate about 20 to 30 acres. So they are very strong in technology. The technology has developed there. The reason was, it was a necessity for them to go for a technology. It is a water-starving country. The water what they are using is not of recent origin. It is about 5,000 years old water they are using. So that is, they have to draw the water from the maximum depth. So they know the value of water. They were forced. They were cornered. They were, just because they were forced to go for technology in order to minimize the usage of water and use it judiciously to cultivate more land. They have developed the technology and they are using the technology in order to cultivate more land with a minimum water. But whereas we are using more water and cultivating less land, same time we are producing less amount of food grains per acre than some of the other countries, particularly the developed countries. So now, so even if you just see, now look into the history, and probably you might know, many of you must be remembering, Tughlaq was there. He was ruling the western part of the Karnataka. He had changed the capital n number of times. Not one or two times. Why he has been forced to change the capitals was only the water. Whenever a capital city faces the water crisis, immediately look for the alternative capital. Okay? So, I just want to make it very clear that water is supposed to be a finite, a resource. We don't have the huge quantity of water. It is, what I want to say is, it's a fixed quantity. We get in the form of rainfall or in the form of a snowfall. So it's not increasing. It's not decreasing. There might be some changes in the season during which we receive the rain because of the environmental, the problem, the climatic, the changes. But we are getting the same amount of rainfall what we were getting 100 years before or 200 years before or even 1000 years before. So the water is same, but over a period of time the usage of water has been has increased significantly, thereby the resources are getting dried up and we have not changed our practices, the agriculture, the irrigation practices, thereby we have come at the verge of a total collapse. Unless we take this matter seriously, look into the various options, how best the available resources can be used or managed, the days or years ahead are going to be very, very, very miserable. Certainly, the future generations will certainly blame the past generations. Now, if you just see the rainfall, we are fortunate that our mean annual rainfall is much more than the mean annual rainfall of this entire world. You can just see this one. The Indian mean annual rainfall is 1170 mm. But whereas the world's average is only 870 mm. There are some countries with a minimum of 800 mm, they are not facing the water crisis. Particularly most of the Western countries, they receive the water in the form of a snowfall, not in the form of a rainfall. So when they receive the water in the form of a snowfall, the runoff will be very, very, very minimal. But whereas we get here, water in the form of a rainfall, not in the form of a snowfall. So whatever the rain we get, so immediately most of the water, almost 70% of the water will go off as a surface runoff. Very less water will be left behind. And it might be there in the form of a surface water, maybe in the lakes or in the rivers or in the streams or in the tanks and reservoirs. And part of the water might go into the subsurface and form as a groundwater resource. So one of the major problems what we are facing is the spatial and temporal variations. Spatial and temporal variation. Even if we get minimum of 800 mm per year, if it is spread throughout the year, the 800 mm throughout the year, if it is equally spread, there won't be any possibility for water crisis. Though we are getting more rainfall, since spatially as well as temporally, the entire rain, that is 1170 mm, we get maybe in 30 or 40 days, we get that entire rainfall. So thereby, most of the water is going off as a surface runoff, and we are facing the problem. And also, spatially. You can just see now there is a place called Tirupanji. So we get almost 11,000 mm rainfall. And there are places like Ladakh and the Western Rajasthan. There are places like these two where the rainfall will be in the order of only 100 mm. The irony is, the place where 11,000 mm rainfall is there, they are facing the water crisis. The place where the rainfall is only 100 mm, they are also facing the water crisis. So when they are getting more and more water, there should not be any water crisis. But still they are facing the water crisis. And even in the place where the rainfall is minimum, they are also facing the water crisis, indicating that we are very, 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 very poor in the water resources management. So we don't know literally how best the water can be used so that it will be beneficial for the entire nation. Right? So the best way to understand how best the water can be used is to go and watch the people, how they are using, how they are managing the water resources in the places where the rainfall is 100 or 110 mm. Right? So these things must be known to everybody. It is obvious factors, obvious reasons. The reasons for the increase in the water scarcity, one is population. And another one is the food demand. So it is, both are interlinked. And the next one is irrigation and the power demand. The demand for the power. Okay, next. Now if you just look into the population, the figures are there. You can just see right from 1911 up to 2001 how the population is. So at the time of independence, maybe close to independence, 1941, the population was only 31 crores or 32 crores. Or let it be even 35 crores during 1947. The population was only 35 crores. And if we just see prior to that, 1920s, there was a negative growth in the population. Negative growth in the population. It is because of lack of the medical facilities. And those days, the death rate was much more than the birth rate. So now you just see, it's 2001, the population was about 103 crores. Now it might have become the 110 or 115 crores. And in the year 2050, the population is certainly going to be 150 crores. How are we going to manage the food grains? How are we going to manage the power production? How are we going to manage the water for the drinking purpose? So these are the questions before us. Unless we are conscious about the availability of the water and how it has to be used, certainly we'll be risking our life in the near future. Maybe I'm fortunate, I may not be seeing now 2050, but most of you must be alive in the year 2050, and you are going to recollect what I'm saying right now. Even if you just go out with a water bottle, your life will not be sure. You will not be sure of your life. Even if you just wear a gold, 1 kg of gold, and then one bottle in hand, they won't touch the gold. So they might snatch. They might even kill you just for the sake of a bottle of water. That day is going to come surely unless we now wake up and try to look for ways and means to manage the resources and improve the technology in order to utilize the water judiciously, so that maybe the flashpoint, the problem can be postponed a bit, maybe for another 50 years or 60 years or 100 years. But a day will come, this entire world is going to be perished in the absence of the water. You just imagine, if there is no water supply at all in the campus for about 15 days, you just imagine how your life will be. It is going to affect overall. If there is no water supply within the campus, you cannot ensure the presence of the students in the classroom. So that's what it has been reported by the UN, United Nations, saying that in the African countries, in the African countries, particularly the student population is decreasing. The absentees of students is almost about 20%. The main reason quoted was only the lack of the protected water in the premises of the education institutions. Now it's going to affect not only the food production, it's going to affect even in many farms, so thereby the life becomes very, very miserable. So you can also just see now the disparities in the growth of the population within the India, and we can also compare the Indian population with the China. Now how clever they are and how judicious they are to control the population. So you can just see now China 1960 the growth rate was 2.2, and now 1990 it has come down to 1.9. In 2001 it was 1. But whereas we have not reached even 2002, we have not reached 1. So still our growth rate is somewhere around 1.6 or 1.8. So within India, we can just see the disparity between North and South. So in the South India, the population growth rate is 1.2. North India, it is 2.3. Maybe in the North India, people might, the politicians might thought that they can rule the country if at all if the population in the North is more, so that they will have more MPs and then they can become prime ministers and chief ministers and all. The major reason for this is we have not built up the essential things for the sustenance of the human beings in the Indian subcontinent. The very first thing is the infrastructure, the other one is the health, and then the education. Even still we can just see, you know, in some of the tribal areas, there are no schools at all. Even if schools are there, there are no students. If the students are there, there are no teachers. So with this kind of the facilities in the country, it is very difficult for us to stabilize the population or to control the population. Unless you can control the population, so it is not going to, the problem is not going to be solved. And it is going to aggravate in multiples, and thereby every one of us in the Indian subcontinent has to face the misery of the water scarcity. So now we just see now the population density, the global population, it is about 45 persons per square kilometers, and India it is about 324 persons per square kilometers. Asia it is 116, and even China, though it is highly populous, it is about only 133 people per square kilometer. So the density of the population also is unfortunately very, very, very high in the Indian subcontinent, adding troubles to the existing problems. And the per capita land availability also, in 1951, the per capita, per person, the available land in Indian subcontinent is 1 acre, and the same thing, it has been reduced to 0.4 acres in 2001. So maybe in 2050, it might be a few cents, right? So this, unless we try to target the population control, is not that easy for us to solve this, the water problem. Next one. You can also just see these food grains. 1947, the requirement was 50, and 1990, 170, 2050, and now 2001, 250 million tons. And 2050, it is about 450 million tons are required to feed the entire population in the Indian subcontinent. The problem here is not the food grains. How do you produce the food grains without water? It is impossible. So in order to produce more food grains, then you should have more and more the water. So that's what I told you earlier. The population control is very, very, very essential to minimize this the particular problem. Right now, the food grains available is only 460 grams per day per the person. The minimum requirement is 575. So that's why the malnutrition is one of the prevalent the problems the country is facing, and thereby most of the newly born children are underweight. Okay. So the next one, almost about 47% of the children are underweight children, and infant mortality is 66% per 1,000. Okay. So all these things, are related to the availability of water. If we have more water, more land, we can produce more food grains, we can supply more for each person. So thereby, this kind of this kind of infant mortality as well as the underweight problem can be very well tackled. Next one. So this is again the land irrigation particulars. So 1950, now we were irrigating about 21 million hectares. 1970 it has gone up to 77, and 2000 it has come to 2000 also it is about to 77. But 140 million million hectares we have to irrigate or cultivate to feed the population in 2050. So in order to cultivate 140 million hectares of land, they require additional water, and whatever the water that is going as a waste in the river systems has to be properly conserved, and then we have to meet out for the future needs. So, you know, the land per capita available, that's what I told you earlier, and present rate of production, I told you earlier, the rate of production per acre of land in India is very, 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 very low when compared with other developed countries. So, present rate of production, so 1 ton per acre of land. Per acre of land, we are producing only 1 ton. But whereas possible rate of production, the production rate can be increased to 3 tons. So, thereby, we'll be using less amount of water, we'll be irrigating less extent of land, and thereby, we'll be able to conserve more and more water. Next. So, now we just see the per capita available water and world scenario. So India is only hardly 2020 cubic meters per year per person is available. Per person it is about 2200 cubic meters that is available, and suppose if it is reduced to 1700, it will be considered as the water stress region, and if it comes down to 1000, it will be declared as the water scarcity region. If it is declared as water scarcity region, so most of the people may not be having the protected water and also water for sanitation purpose, and thereby the health of the people will be very much affected. And if you just come to the erstwhile ESSR, 17,500 cubic meters of water is available per person. Japan, 6,500 cubic meters. USA, 6,200 cubic meters of the water. The future, now in the future, who is going to rule this world is only the country which is having huge water resources. So like now if you just go back to earlier, whichever country was so strong, they were ruling the entire world. So afterwards, whichever country was rich in resources like oil and all those things, they were ruling the entire world. So in future, whichever country is very, very rich in water, it is going to dictate terms to the other countries. So if we just wanted to stand up and then show our identity, show our presence among the world nations, so we also have to see to that the entire water that is available in the form of rain is kept and is used for the various needs, and also we have to conserve the water so that the problem can be addressed up to 2050. Next one. Now this is the status of water resources national scenario. I told you earlier the rainfall is 117 mm, and volume of if you convert the entire rainfall into volume, it is about 4000 cubic kilometers of water will be available in the form of rainfall, and the entire 4000 cubic kilometers of water we are not using, so there will be some wastage of water. So all these things like estimated water flow from the rivers, it is 1,880 cubic kilometers. So where this rest of the water is going is, maybe the rain must be falling in the inaccessible areas, that we will not be able to use it. And also there must be evaporation losses and interception losses and infiltration. So because of these things, so only 1,880 cubic kilometers of volume of water is available for our the needs. And again, within that, so usable or utilizable water is only 1140, that is 1,140 cubic kilometers of water is available. And it is about, so again, if you just convert that into surface and groundwater, it is 690 cubic kilometers of water surface water and 450 is the groundwater. Now, number of storage reservoirs, if at all if you wanted to use that entire water that is available, available water, that is 1140 cubic kilometers of water, we require additionally large and medium dams, 3000, and tanks, almost about 2 lakh tanks are required, so that the entire water that is there in the river systems can be kept utilized for various needs. Still, there is so much of water which is going as a surface runoff and going into the sea as a waste. So now we just see the water demand. So in 1990, 630 cubic kilometers of water was the demand. 2,770. In 2025, it is 1,140. So in 2025, our demand and then available water, that is 1,140 available water, total water will be same. After 2025, any additional requirement, obviously there will be increase in population, increase in food grains, and then increase in the cultivation. Obviously there will be more and more demand. For that increasing demand, there won't be any water at all, right? So after 2025, we may be comfortable with available water. After 2025, the situation will be very, very pathetic or miserable. So this is about the Pondicherry scenario, and I told earlier that the rainfall is slightly higher than the national average. It is 1281 mm rainfall we receive here in Pondicherry. The number of days, it is a monsoon period 135 days and non-monsoon period 49 days, totally 184 days. It is including, even if there is a 1 mm or 2 mm rainfall, all that has been recorded. Okay? So here the number of rainy days is slightly higher. But the real impact of rain on the surface water or on the groundwater will be significantly less on most part of the period. Right? So the groundwater available here is in sedimentary formations, and the water table, it varies significantly from 0.2 meters to 50.5 meters. And now there is so much of the pumping of water, and thereby the entire aquifer along the coast has been contaminated due to salt water intrusion, and the freshwater resources have been reduced, and it is reducing, and it will be reducing even in future also unless some remedial measures are taken up. Next. The next one. So this is about the surface runoff and surface water and groundwater utilization. So here the surface water utilization is almost has come to negligible. So the bottom one, so in the year 2000 or so, 1990 or so, the amount of surface water that is available and we are using is almost come to zero. For all purposes, either for drinking or industries or for agriculture, only we are tapping water from the subsurface. That is, only we are depending on the groundwater. Next. Okay, next. So now we just come to the rainwater, the harvesting. So we have the various ways and means. So one is depending upon the terrain, depending upon the place where we wanted to harvest, like if it is like a urban and hilly terrain, so we can go for roof water harvesting, store water and reuse, and groundwater, and we can also go for the groundwater. So there are two options are there. So whatever the water that falls on the roof, you collect it and use it, reuse it. The other one is, so whatever the water that comes from the roof, see to that it goes below the surface of the earth, so that the groundwater resources will be improved. So if you use that in the form of a groundwater, the operational losses will be quite the minimum. So the next one is the methods of harvesting, the recharge tube wells, recharge open wells, the groundwater, ground level reservoirs and underground reservoirs. Next. So this is what, in fact, I'll just tell you, the Pondicherry is supposed to be a heaven for groundwater resource development. You take your own campus, it's a beautiful campus with so many ravines and huge does the catchment area. So during the rainy season, particularly peak rainy season,
the huge amount of water will be passing through the ravines in the form of surface runoff. It just goes into this. So in fact, I heard that it has been tried earlier to go for a check dams. And one of the check dams must be there, just maybe backside of the women's hostel. Now, some of you might have seen that one. And it has been ill-planned and then constructed. Thereby, the purpose was not served. And university can be converted as a model campus for groundwater, the harvesting, maybe in the form of storing and using, or otherwise, you can see to that the water that is stored goes into the subsurface so that the groundwater resources will be improved. This is a very simple example. So what is that you have to do is, in case if subsurface, subsurface is very congenial to go for the rainwater harvesting for groundwater recharge, a small pit is enough. So this type of small pits have been constructed in most of the government buildings in Pondicherry, so that whatever the rainwater that is falling on the roof of the buildings, they are collecting into the recharge pit and sending that water into the subsurface. The next one, please. So this is again another schematic diagram which demonstrate how the water can be collected and where it has to be, where it has to be stored and how it has to be reused. Next one, please. Next one. Next one. Next. So this is what we have done on an experimental basis in our campus. So this recharge well has been constructed just by side of the civil engineering department in order to harvest the entire surface, entire water that is falling on the roof of the building, and it is. So this is actually it's not a open well, it is a open well come a bore. So what you are seeing is a pit, a small pit, which has been constructed to a depth of 10 feet. From the 10 feet depth, a borehole has been drilled. So what you are seeing, the pipe, you have here the perforations. You can just see here the perforations. Whatever the water that come into this pit goes through these perforations, and then directly it will be left at a depth of 60 feet. So why it has been left at a 60 feet depth is, the water table is there at 80 feet depth. So we cannot take this water directly to the water table. So otherwise, if any contaminants are there, the groundwater will be contaminated. So that's the reason. So we have drilled up to 60 feet, and this is a screen. Okay, the water goes into the screen, and directly it will go up and go to a depth of 60 feet, where again the perforations will be there. The water will spread automatically. Ultimately, the entire water reaches the subsurface. And in fact, now this has been designed in order to collect and recharge 2,500 cubic meters of water per year. So our requirement for the department is only 1,500 cubic meters per year to meet all the requirements for drinking as well as for sanitary purpose and all that, for cleaning, washing, all these things. Our demand, our requirement was 1,500 cubic meters. What we have, what we started collecting is around 1,500 cubic meters of water. That means 2,500 cubic meters of water. That means we are just sending 1,000 cubic meters of water into the subsurface, back into the ground, back into the subsurface, so that the groundwater table will be improved. Okay, so we are using only 1,500 cubic meters. We are sending back only, in the sense, we are using literally 500 cubic meters of the water. Okay, this is what line sketch. This is what the line sketch. It's a pit of 3 meters depth. Pit of 3 meters depth, and this is the perforations what you are seeing there. And now the gravel has been filled here. The gravel has been filled filled in the pit in order to see to that the contaminants, particularly the suspended material, is retained within this filter media. So the clear water goes straight away up, straight away at 15 meters depth. It goes into the subsurface. Here the soil is highly permeable. It consists of gravel as well as sand and the silt. And since it is so permeable, any amount of water that is passing through this one will be dispersed immediately so that there won't be any overflow of the rainwater recharge system. Okay? We have not seen so far, it is about 10 years old, so far we have not seen the system overflowing. So this type of recharge wells can be constructed all over the campus, and this campus is very suitable for construction of a tech dam, so that it can also be converted as introduce boats and all that, so that it's like a recreation, it becomes even a recreation the center. And unfortunately, so far, nobody has given a thought into this particular area. So it is you, it is your campus, and maybe you'll be here maybe for about 2 or 3 years or 5 years or 6 years, but still, this is supposed to be your alma mater, and it is your bound duty to impress upon the authorities of this particular campus to make this as a model campus for groundwater resource development. You can improve the surface water, you can also improve the groundwater resources. But in fact, now whenever I just enter into the campus, the very first thing that strike in my mind is, campus is so beautiful, at what cost? We have a nice garden here, nice lawn here, at what cost? The same thing has happened even in Australia, almost about 6 or 7 years back. Suppose if the house owners use water for the lawn or for car cleaning, they used to charge almost about $100 fine. The problem was so severe, they were not able to supply water for even drinking purpose, so they have made a resolution. They passed the government order saying that the water should not be used for other than the drinking and domestic purpose. So whomsoever used that water, they have been heavily punished by imposing the fines. So such problem is going to come even in India, and we have to be very, very judicious when you are using water. And surprisingly, I have seen one thing in our campus. Many of us doesn't do it. A cow has come to a tap. Tap was closed. Right? It has opened it. I was just watching the entire thing. It has opened it. It drank water. After that, again it has closed and went up. How many apples are there? That's what we just see, the leakage of water inside the campus, within each building. The wastage of water will be almost about 30%. We never bother. We use more power to draw the water. We supply the more water, but we never bother about the loss. So it is a natural waste. We are now wasting the energy. We are wasting the water resources. Now these things, why I am telling is, many people does it. Even the student does it. They just open the tap and go off. So we have to be very cautious. We have to live in the present. What we are doing, we have to do it consciously. Use water, use it. Open the tap. Use the water, then see to that it is closed. So by doing this one, so you can save a lot of water, and you can save energy, and you can also conserve the water resources. So this is the way you can try to improve the groundwater resources even within this campus. This particular system is the only system which is suitable for improving the groundwater resources in this particular environment, not only in this campus, anywhere within the Pondicherry. This system can be adopted so that the groundwater resources can be improved substantially. Now these are all the pictures, the methods of the harvesting. So one is basin method. You might have seen this. Now this is like this system is there in the heart of a city, one of the European countries. So the river is flowing, and on either side, city has spread, and you have the basins. So whenever there is a huge flow in the river, it will be diverted into the basins, so they retain more. The main logic is, in order to improve the harvest the water, there are only three ways. One is
increasing the contact area for the water. More and more contact area, more and more water will go in. Increasing the hydraulic head. There is only 1 meter height of the water. The amount of water seep through the soil will be less. There is 10 feet height, obviously, or 10 meters height, obviously more amount of water will be.